is my home. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I will sail the wide sea no more.
Say violin, we say fiddle.
Yeah. We'll see if Vince Gill can come.
Right.
Say what?
We'll see if Vince Gill can come. He plays mandolin.
Who does?
Vince Gill.
Vince Gill, yes. We'd love to have him, for sure. Well, this song, you've heard it before, says, knowing you'll be there makes it easy for me to go home.
Yeah.
The other day I passed the place you always like to go, and I picked up the phone because I thought you'd like to know. But I forgot you weren't there. I miss you all these days. When I'm reminded of your smile and the funny things you'd say, I see you both at Christmas time. You were like a little kid. You always loved the good surprise. Now I'm lost again. That I long more for heaven than I ever did before. You give me one more reason why, and each day I want it more. Knowing reminiscing on the past, knowing I will see your face again, your tender warm smile. It makes me want to go You left the group of fishermen. Somehow you left me too. But I felt you by my side. Though you saw me through, I've always longed to feel your arms and look into your eyes and talk forever, me and you, somewhere in paradise. Knowing we could spend a lifetime reminiscing on the past, knowing I will see your face again, where tender moments last. It makes me want to go there, knowing I won't be alone. Knowing you'll be there makes it easy to knowing you'll be there makes it easy to go home.
Amen. That was good.
Very good.
First Samuel chapter 26. First Samuel chapter 26. We have been making our way through the book of First Samuel in a series called Studies in the Life of a Man After God's Own Heart. Today we pick up where we left off last week, chapter 26. As I often do, I'd like to quote Romans chapter 15 and verse 4, where the Bible says, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope." And my point is that God's trying to teach us something by the biography of the life of David. David was a regular person, just like you and I. He was deeply flawed, yet deeply spiritual. You say, "Preacher, can you be both?" You can. You can be deeply flawed, because the fact of the matter is we all are. And yet, we can be deeply spiritual if we desire to be. And we labor to be, we seek to be. And David was that dichotomy. That is a tale of two men. So God wants to teach us something. Let's begin reading verse number 1. "And the Ziphites came unto Saul to Gibeah, saying, Doth not David hide himself in the hill of Hakilah, which is before Jeshimon? Then Saul arose and went down to the wilderness of Ziph, having 3,000 chosen men of Israel with him, to seek David in the wilderness of Ziph. Saul pitched in the hill of Hakilah, which is before Jeshimon, by the way. But David abode in the wilderness, and he saw that Saul came after him into the wilderness. David therefore sent out spies and understood that Saul was come in very deed." That just simply means that he was in fact there. "David arose and came to the place where Saul had pitched, and David beheld the place where Saul lay. And Abner, the son of Ner, the captain of his host, and Saul lay in the trench, and the people pitched round about him. Then answered David and said to Ahimelech the Hittite and to Abishai the son of Zeruiah, brother to Joab, saying, Who will go down with me to Saul to the camp? And Abishai, I said, I'll go down with thee. So David and Abishai came to the people by night, and behold, Saul lay sleeping within the trench, and his spear stuck in the ground at his bolster. But Abner and the people lay round about him. Then said Abishai to David, God hath delivered thine enemy into thine hand this day. Now therefore let me smite him, I pray thee, with the spear even to the earth at once. And I will not smite him the second time. And David said to Abishai, I destroy him not. For who can stretch forth his hand against the Lord's anointed and be guiltless? David said, furthermore, as the Lord liveth, the Lord shall smite him, for his day shall come to die, for he shall descend into battle and perish. The Lord forbid that I should stretch forth mine hand against the Lord's anointed. But I pray thee, take thou now the spear that is at his bolster and the cruse of water, and let us go. So David took the spear and the cruse of water from Saul's bolster, and they gat them away. No man saw it, nor knew it, neither awaked, for they were all asleep because of a deep sleep from the Lord was fallen upon them. David had a force of about 600 men, which means he was outnumbered times what?
5 to 1.
5 to 1. And yet, he's the victor. Listen, our enemy is very strong. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's pray. And let you pray as I pray that God would speak to your heart and give you something that would be a help and a blessing today. Father, we do love you. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for these Old Testament stories. Lord, I'm excited to hear Brother Paul's going to be teaching us about Daniel. What a great man of God that he was. How exciting it is to hear those stories, Lord. Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, and their faith. Would they rather be thrown in a fiery furnace than to deny their God? Oh, Lord, what a blessing. They're written for our learning. Help us learn. I pray you'll speak to our hearts from the Word of God this morning. I pray you'll give us understanding. I pray you'll enable your preacher, Lord. Without you, I can do nothing. And so we ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus. The Lord, teach us something. We'll be grateful in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
When we last left the man after God's own heart, he had foolishly ignored the Word of God and married a second wife, thereby making himself a transgressor of the law. As we noted last week, the Bible says that the way of transgressors is hard. That's true whether it's a lost man, that's true whether it's a saved man. If you and I, as born again children of God, choose to walk in sin, we will make the way hard for us. David's causing himself more problems than he needs right here. The way of a transgressor is hard. It is an immutable fact of life. Sin invites trouble in our life. In fact, sin guarantees trouble in our life. Sin invites disaster. And so it's no wonder that the Bible says that the way of the transgressor is hard. But the good thing about all that trouble and all that heartache brought on by our disobedience is that sooner or later we tend to get the message that the price for sin is just simply too high. It's not worth it, amen?
Amen.
You know, the Bible said that there's pleasure in sin, but it's only for a season. The seasons come and go pretty quick.
Amen.
And I've got a message that I haven't preached in a long time. I don't remember last time, but the title of the message is Three Things That Sin Will Do For You. Mm-hmm. Number one, sin will always keep you longer than you ever intended to stay. Sin will always cost you more than you ever intended to pay, and sin will always take you farther than you ever intended to go. The Bible says in 1 Peter 4:1 that he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin. My daddy believed in that principle, amen. When I do wrong, he makes sure I suffered in the flesh for it, amen. But, and then I wouldn't do it again. But then we also noted last week how that when our fellowship with God is broken, that our judgment becomes clouded. We begin to make bad choices and bad decisions. I said when our fellowship with God is broken, then our judgment becomes clouded. We begin to make bad choices and bad decisions. That's what David's done here. We all say that once a child touches a hot burner, a hot stove, he'll not do it again. And that's generally true. But here in our text, David has been burnt once before by these same Ziphites. And yet here he is sticking his hand right back on that same hot burner. And again, I'm telling you that when we begin to walk down a pathway of disobedience, we open ourselves up to all kinds of unnecessary trials and tribulations. But I like what Paul wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 2, where he said that if we believe not, even if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. I'm so glad that God don't turn his back on me when I mess up.
Amen.
Thank God he abides faithful. He doesn't cast us out when we mess up. He just continues to suffer long with us. You know, I thank God for a lot of things every day. One of the things I thank him for is being long-suffering with old Brother Randy. Amen. The Bible says that the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth and hath long patience for it. Thank God. He must be because he's still working on me. Amen. I like that little chorus the children used to sing. He's still working on me. Make me what I ought to be. Took him just a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth and Jupiter and Mars. How loving and patient he must be. Why? He's still working on me. Well, there are three or four observations I'd like to make from this 26th chapter here today. And then next week, Lord willing, it'll be buckle your seatbelt time again as David takes us on another wild ride over in chapter 27. But I'd like to begin with number one, the reprehensible conduct of the empty. The reprehensible conduct of the empty. And as we go along, you'll understand what I mean. The word reprehensible is defined as deserving of rebuke, or reproof, or censure. First of all, let's talk about just who were these Ziphites who were tattling on David. Were they Canaanites? Were they Moabites? Were they Hittites? All of these Gentiles? Were they Amalekites? No. No. Who were these treacherous Ziphites? Well, they were Israelites. And not only were they Israelites, but they were of the tribe of Judah. In other words, David was of the tribe of Judah. In other words, they were his brethren. They were of the same womb. That's what that word brethren means, of the same womb. That's why we call one another brother in the house of God, because we're all of the same spiritual womb. We've all been born again into the family of God.
Amen.
But again, David, of these Ziphites, David might have reasonably expected to be betrayed by a bunch of heathen, of the Canaanites or the Hittites or the Amalekites, but these Ziphites were fellow citizens with David of the household of faith. And to top it all off, King Saul didn't even ask for their help. They just volunteered it twice. You say, preacher, what is your point? Well, as I told you in our last study, King Saul is a type and a picture of our adversary, the devil, who walketh about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. David is a type and a picture of the faithful but desperately flawed Christian, who is nevertheless a man or a woman after God's own heart. And these treacherous Ziphites are a type and a picture of some of our so-called brothers and sisters who inexplicably salivate over the opportunity to help out the devil by spreading ruinous gossip about another brother or sister in Christ. It is the epitome of treachery, and it's reprehensible. And again, my first point is the reprehensible conduct of the empty. You say, preacher, why do you refer to these people as the empty? Because they are people who are devoid of the fullness of the Spirit of God, devoid of the grace of God in their hearts, devoid of any real godly Christian character whatsoever. They are an empty suit masquerading as brethren. And I promise you, if you've ever been the victim of malicious slander by another Christian, then you know what I'm talking about. Amen?
Yeah.
Now, David went to Ziph seeking shelter from his murderous enemy, and that among kinfolk of his own tribe, and he reasonably expected to be hospitably received, and he found none. Likewise, people come to the house of God seeking shelter, and from the cares of this world, and from their adversary, the devil, reasonably expecting to be hospitably received. And far too often, in church after church after church, they're met with cold, inhospitable people just looking for an opportunity to betray. We want to make sure we never become a church like that. Amen.
Amen.
We want to make sure that, you sang about the haven of rest this morning, we want to make sure that the house of God is a haven of rest.
Amen.
For the weary traveler. Amen. Not only reprehensible conduct of the empty, but secondly, I want to talk about the reliable return of the enemy. That's in verse 2. Let me read that again. There it says, then Saul arose. When he got word, then Saul arose and went down to the wilderness of Ziph, having 3,000 chosen men of Israel with him to seek David in the wilderness of Ziph. The reliable return of the enemy. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this point, but the last time that Saul came hunting for David to kill him, you recall that David and his men were hiding in a cave in a place called Engedi. And Saul cluelessly wandered in that cave where David and his men were hiding. And he lay down and went fast asleep. And the Bible says that David privily cut off the skirt of his robe and could have killed him that day, but did not. Long story short, Saul weeps, slings some snot, and in essence he tells David that he won't bother him anymore. Oh, you're a better man than I am, David. That's what he said. I'll never bother you again. Well, here he is again.
Yeah, here he is.
Two chapters later, with 3,000 men, 3,000 trained assassins, quote, to seek David in the wilderness of Ziph. First of all, the Bible says in James chapter 4, and this is our Sunday school verse Brother Red's been leading us in, he said, for you and I to submit ourselves to God. And then he said, resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
Amen.
But you can bet your bottom dollar he won't be gone for long. He's coming back, amen, again and again and again and again. And we have to continuously submit ourselves unto God and continuously resist the devil and for him to flee. Which brings me to my third point. Number three, the relative impotence of the enemy. The relative impotence of the enemy. Let me explain to you what I mean by relative impotence of the enemy. I mean, here's King Saul, the single most powerful man in all of Israel, perhaps the single most powerful man in all the world. He's commander-in-chief of Israel's armed forces. At his word, he could immobilize perhaps a million men or more, fighting men, to go after David, little old David. But he reasoned that 3,000 men ought to be enough. Again, he's got them outnumbered 5-1. We're talking about a very powerful foe, a very powerful enemy who is hell-bent on killing David. Likewise, folks, our adversary, the devil, is a very powerful foe. He too is a king. He is referred to in the Bible as the prince and the power of the air. He too has a large army of assassins called demon spirits, fallen angels. He's called also the God of this world. He reigns and rules in the hearts of billions and billions of people here on this planet. He so thoroughly ruled in the hearts and minds of one man called Adolf Hitler that by the time the smoke cleared in 1945, upwards of 50 million people had lost their lives, and much of Europe lay in ruins. Our adversary is without question a very powerful foe. He's not to be taken lightly. But I'm talking about the relative impotence of our enemy. That word relative is defined as, quote, considered in comparison to. So our enemy is impotent considered in comparison to who? Our God, our Heavenly Father. And the Bible says in 1 John 4:4, I believe it is, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I mean, again, here is this mighty king, 3,000 specially trained fighters camped out on a hillside by the road. They've set a perimeter. They've set a series of sentries ever so many feet apart. Around that perimeter, King Saul is smack dab in the middle, and they're all fast asleep, snoring. The whole shooting match, fast asleep. Because the Bible says in verse 12 of our text, for they were all asleep because a deep sleep from the Lord was fallen upon them.
Amen.
I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, the same is true. I used to fear the devil. I don't fear him anymore.
Amen.
Now, we don't have nothing to be afraid of.
Right.
The Bible says that fear hath torment. Over and over again, you find the words fear not in the Bible. Compared to God, our adversary, the devil, is a flea who may be allowed to annoy us and harass us from time to time, but never will he be allowed to overwhelm us or overtake us. In Psalm 34:7, the Bible says that the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them. Again, it was the Apostle John who wrote, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Which leads me to my last point, and I'm done. Number four, the resolute confidence of those that have been established. The resolute confidence of those that have been established in the faith. This was not David's first rodeo. He had been down this road before. He had experienced firsthand time and time and time again the supernatural power of God in his life and the supernatural protection of God in his life. Once against a lion, you know the story. Once against a bear when he was just a shepherd boy. The lion came and tried to steal a lamb and in fact did grab a little lamb. David went out and killed the lion. How many of you feel like you could take on a lion? Boy, he did. Then a bear came and decided he wanted a lamb for lunch, you know, leg of lamb. I've never had a lamb, I don't think, but must be pretty good. Here comes a bear. And David said, no, you're not. And he killed the bear. And then one day he was delivering food to his brothers who was in the army fighting against the Philistines, and he heard Goliath, this great big giant, defying the armies of the living God. Made David mad. He killed the giant. I said, this was not David's first rodeo. Amen. Not a hint of consternation, not a hint of fear. No speech to his men about how dangerous a mission it was going to be and how that they might not make it back alive. I'm talking about the resolute confidence of those that have been established in the faith. Thank God, I've been saved 47 years. It's not my first rodeo either, amen. I've been around the block a time or two, and so have you. And those experiences where God came through for you,
yes,
time and time again, has served to establish you in the faith.
Amen.
And make you unafraid of the enemy.
That's right.
And old David here, he said, which one of you boys want to go down with me to the camp of Saul? And old Abishai, I said, I'll go with you. Just 2,000-3,000 plus down there. David's going to go. He's unafraid. No matter, I'm talking about your Redeemer and my Redeemer has proven himself time and time again to be absolutely reliable and sufficiently powerful to meet every need in your life.
Amen.
No matter what comes your way. So that we can be unshakable and unmovable, resolute in our trust to the living God. Again, no matter what comes our way, the resolute confidence of the established. Over there in, I believe it's 1st or 2nd Peter, he talks about after that you've suffered a while, that you will become established in the faith. I would never have chosen some of the sufferings that God has permitted me to experience, and neither would you. Things have happened in your life that you would never have chosen.
Yeah.
But they have served to fortify you, to make you strong and resolute in your faith, in your trust of the faithfulness of God.
Yes, sir.
And anyway, that's my message this morning. Studies in the life of a man after God's own heart. Why do we study the life of David? Because we are men and women here today who are in fact men and women after God's own heart. We're in pursuit of him. And we can learn from David, amen. And we have it. Brother Paul's going to come and lead us in a hymn of invitation. We're going to stand together. And if you have a need, I invite you to come.